wird jetzt. So, welcome to my second talk about Gion. I see I'm successfully managed to drive some folks away. A very good score. How to survive under Gion control. So this will be a complete opposite of the last session, both in topic and in structure. We will be seeing a lot of PowerShell code. Nothing of that is magic. It's just to highlight what issues you folks could become could be facing when operating under Gion control. So in this session, I will talk about what's in store for you, give some insights into what to look at in your existing PowerShell code to enable this it to run in this environment, and most importantly, I come from operations to communicate your finding and help this communication make your organization's Gion implementation even better. So, is there anybody here who didn't attend my last talk? Okay. Is there anybody in this room who would, in case of a Gion implementation in their organization, find themselves in this role? I'm starting tomorrow, I'm a constrained administrator, so have to cope with what's imposed upon me. No, okay. Well, nevertheless, one of the most important parts of Gion implementations is communication to the application owners and infrastructure owners. So if you get the memo that anybody is planning to implement Gion in your environment, get on board. I will be sharing some Word document templates that helped in the past, checklists and such stuff. So go out to the application owners, talk to them, try to gather as much information as possible. What permissions do the application need? What maybe external commands, DOS commands, they need to have their stuff running and to be able to manage that, right? So embark on this journey prepared. So what will be happening if Gion gets implemented in an environment? You won't be able to execute your admin rights over RDP or RPC, so all those fancy MMC consoles suddenly don't work anymore because you get stripped of your admin rights. You're not going to be able to RDP in a machine and do stuff locally. And then comes, okay, this you need to deal with. PowerShell can't help there. You just need to be aware that you have to prepare, you have to find ways, maybe research some commandlets, research some modules that help replace the tools you were accustomed with, and communicate that to the management so you actually get to implement and use those tools. But this is not what we will be talking about here. So getting stripped of admin rights and getting stripped of RDP access. The last part, dealing with restricted language mode, would be completely outside of the scope of this conversation in terms of time. We could like spend the whole day talking about restricted language mode and how to overcome that. But you need to but you need to read up on that, because somebody could come up with the idea to implement that as a part of the G implementation. Here in the middle is the part we're going to talk about, not being able to connect to the default endpoint, because who can connect to the default endpoint in the default configuration? It's admins, WinRM users, and locally interactively logged on users, right? So if you're not one of those, you're stuck. Adjusting to working with Run S accounts, which can have different identities and different permissions from your own account. Double hop authentication issues, which actually are not a part in any way of Gia, but it's classic Kerberos. Not finding all commandlets, functions, and parameters. I mean, interactively, it's irritating. In a script, it can be devastating. And the part I talked about in the last talk, unexpected WinRM restarts on the target machines. So if you have been used to connect to the default endpoint, you will need to switch to that in any and all instances of your scripts or code fragments that you use in your daily administration. You need to put configuration name everywhere, and of course with the right configuration endpoint, the one you intend to connect to. PowerShell can help with that. If you only have one endpoint, which would be quite feasible in the canonical Gia delivery modem, model, where we have said we have one endpoint to rule them all, or in the user-centric delivery model, you can set that in your local PowerShell session as the default parameter value for a configuration name. Okay? In the role, in the role-centric delivery model, if you only manage one role and the configuration endpoint for that role has the same name on all machines, then you can use that also. You can put it in your profile so that that gets loaded every time. And so you can keep your existing code. So if you do invoke command, PowerShell will imply you're using invoke command configuration name server management. Putting it in the profile persists that. An interactive PS session requires a special configuration. So if you're used to doing enter PS session, doing stuff exit PS session, it will not work with every endpoint somebody has designed for, let's say, a real remoting, like invoking commands or importing sessions into the default session. There is a number of commandlets that need to be available if you want to do enter PS session. But you can also use new PS session and import PS session, like we basically use for Exchange and Skype. And so on. And if you will be importing commandlets that also are present in your current sessions, you can use a prefix to separate remote from local. Here's how.
Is the list of that commands you need described somewhere in the documentation, or say you need few commandlets to be able to.
The question was if the list of stuff you need to make available in a constraint endpoint to make an entropy as session ready available somewhere on the dock. I haven't found one. I'm sure it's out there, but I wasn't able to find it until now. But I think I have one of those endpoints in my configuration, so I can try to do a blog post on that or something. So, there's a bit of PowerShell code. Demo one. Here is a little module that I made. Finding remoting commandlets in advance in your scripts and modules can help a lot. Of course. So finding remoting code in advance can help a lot to not become confronted with certain limitations of the default endpoint not being accessible in the current session. So it's a simple function. It takes a list of remoting commandlets and commandlets that need admin remote admin write like writes like get WMI object, and just uses AST. We have all learned AST is the way to go if you want to analyze your scripts. It just uses AST and looks if there are commands that are on the list. And here is a simple script. And it has found invoke command on line one and enter PS session on line two. So basically, I just need to look at that and evaluate of if that's going to work with the default endpoint. So setting a default endpoint. Here is another function that doesn't do anything fancy either. It takes a list of three commandlets where a configuration name would be of help to set it to a default endpoint, and it takes two arguments: configuration name or use current username, and I can also choose to persist the configuration in my profile. So it just browses through the variable PS default parameter values and looks if there are those entries. Let's look at that. Let's look at that. And now there are the configuration name parameters set to Gia virtual for all of those parameters. Now I'm a domain admin in this instance. I try to enter a PS session to my only domain controller. And what happens is, okay, this is in German, but it says basically VSMan cannot process this request. I can do, however, this, because on PSConf04, there is a configuration endpoint Gia Virtual. And that's what PowerShell has set for me. Okay? And to be clear, I can always specify another endpoint. So if I really want to connect to that domain controller, I can do that still. Et voilà. So, catching missing commandlets and arguments. Again, doing that prior to execution helps prevent surprises. So if you have a bunch of script lying around somewhere, you can just compare them to a configuration you will find on a machine, provided Gia is in place and you are affected by it. What you also can do is use fully qualified module checking. Then you would be able to, like, specify a module where a commandlet comes from at execution time, in script. It won't help you if that commandlet is missing in your Gia configuration, but it can help if somebody creates some rogue modules. And AST, as seen before, can help checking the entire script code. You can decide on catching the missing commands at execution time. Well, it's tricky. What I've put in here, where performance is an issue, is actually not true. But catching an exception at runtime in a remote session does not come back into the local session as exception. So you need to process that exception on the remote endpoint, right? And if you use try-catch for other stuff within your scripts, it's a good idea to use trap scoped to the missing command exception to prevent unnecessary interactions between the two. So let's see how it could work. Okay. So we import module again. Now, how do we actually find commands? Let's have a look. Get command all is a good bet. Really help. I'm connecting to psconf 04. I get 63 commands. If I do exactly the same thing, but against my Gia-restricted endpoint, it comes back with 9 commands. Okay, it's pretty restricted. That's what we wanted to achieve with Gia. So basically, the stuff that we wanted to compare our code against is there. So these are the 9 commands that get back. Those are defined in that Gia endpoint. If, however, I do the same thing against a machine. It's a Server 2008 R2 machine, and I am admin in God mode. I only get one command, which is definitely not what I expected. So it turns out PowerShell 2.0 expect something like this. And then I end up with 400 commands, which is basically okay. Again, Jira Workstation module. There is a function, find missing commands. And that function takes a bunch of paths, which can be folders or individual scripts, and compares them with a list of the commands I get from that session. So Jira needs to be in place. I need to specify computer name, configuration name, and be logged on as the user in question, which I was. In test data here, I have not very much code, just the one script. Let's compare it to that. So, okay, the command do something is missing. It would probably be missing in any configuration because it's just just put in there for kicks. So what happens if I do the same thing against the restricted endpoint? Okay, invoke command is missing, enter PS session, get service, and again do something is missing because all those commands were not exported by the restricted endpoint. Okay? So now execution time. This is the code that I'll be executing. I'll show you this bit in a minute. Processes, we invoke a get process and then just output how many processes are running and then we start Notepad. Let's have a look how good that works. We could put this code into each and every script every time we invoke something. So every time we invoke a command, we could enclose it in this try-catch statement. It's certainly not a very practicable thing to do, but it would get things done. So if it's basically okay to not be able to find some commandlets in my configuration endpoint, but maybe in one command is critical, I could do that. I could do something else. So there's a bit of cleanup in here. And then, okay, again, I run this code against the default endpoint, which I have access to, and against a constrained endpoint, which I also have access to. 28 processes are running, so the machine is basically not doing much. Oh, command get process is missing, command write host is missing, command start process is missing. Well, let's have a look at the trap statement. It traps a command not found exception, finds out the name of the command, and writes that into a file. Nothing fancy until now, but so these three were written into the file. But the other part that does some, this provides some feedback. It connects back to the developer workstation where the Jira cockpit is running and communicates to the Jira cockpit that somebody has requested those commandlets on that machine. At the moment, it just uses the default identity, so it's Jira Master because that restricted endpoint was configured to run as the Jira Master account. but we'll see in a second how to find out where the actual user is. But now it's been communicated to the Jira Master, and the Jira Master could go out and basically approve this so that the user will have that commandlet available in the next session. Okay? So, how do we know where who the actual user was? In our endpoint configuration, we defined a transcript path to be ctemp. So if we connect to that, we see the transcript of each and every session that were done to one of the configured endpoints. So that is the last one. And we can see I initiated the session as root. The run as user was Jira Master. And by analyzing those files, we also can find out who the user was. This can be automated as well. Working with run as accounts. Local access scenarios. So I remote to a machine and only do some actions on that machine only. You can use a virtual service account, which security wise is probably the best thing you can do. But the permissions you can assign to that account are not very granular. You need to put it in some groups in your endpoint configuration. And if you do not put any groups in there, it will become local admin on that machine, which on ADC is, of course, a domain admin. And you can only use groups local to that target machine, so local groups to a member machine or domain groups on remoting to a domain controller, right? So, if you remote to some member server, the groups need to be there in advance and they need to be assigned permissions in advance. Or you use God mode and run it as an admin on that machine, if that's what is necessary to get the job done. In remote access scenarios, where you access other machines or systems from your remoting session, you have either a pass-through configuration where the session is running in your security context, then you get faced with double hop, or you have a group managed service account, which is awesome if you can get your operations to implement that for you, Or you do an explicit runner's account, which in this case was GeoMaster. It's a domain account with admin rights. And that can help overcome double hop authentication problems. So basically, I could connect to psconf04. We'll do that in a second. As a user that doesn't have admin rights and use the identity of that commandlet to execute those admin rights. The alternative would be using Kerberos delegation, of course, which is scary enough. I mean, many of us have attended Carlos' session, so storing credentials on a Windows box is pretty scary too, even if it uses DPA API, but which it does. So in any scenario, you have potential to start wreaking havoc in your monitoring and threat prevention systems, because virtual accounts are ephemeral. They only exist as long as the session is open, or as long as the session runs. So there might be limited ability to identify the actual caller. This may or may not be a showstopper for your organization, but this is something to be aware of. Right, that's the S132, etc. Oh, okay, I'm sorry. The question was, there are no local admin group on DC, on a DC, what I meant by remoting to a DC and not specifying any groups. But those short, well-known SIDs exist on the DC also, but they pertain to the built-in administrators in the domain. So, run as accounts, just to demonstrate. Oh, I'll close that one. Now here are... So, we have a configuration named GeoVirtual that is configured to run as a virtual account. We enter a PS session into that. And look who we are running with. So it appears that we are running under the computer identity. Default system profile path and psconf04$ as the user identity. We connect to external resources using that. Sort of. We connect to SMB. This is a share on the DC, which has everyone read enabled in it. So the computer, who actually is everyone in a domain, was able to connect to the share. The share too is only shared for a group. The invocation user, which is root, is a member of. But if I run this, I get access denied. Can I remote from this PS session to the DC and get some users? No, I can't. Access is denied. So the user is running in this, basically in the system content. It could do whatever it wants or almost on that machine, but access to other resources can be limited. So now let's look at the configuration geo pass through. I'm running as root. And my profile path is C users root. Happy days. I can ping. And if I try to enumerate files in a share, I also get permission denied. That was the everyone share. This is also true for the share I would have access to as root. So if I try to remote into a domain controller, I get another error message saying that WinRM cannot negotiate Kerberos authentication, which is true, double hop. I'm running locally in the context of root, but that does not translate to a remote access. So explicit credentials. This one is running in an unconstrained configuration. It has all the commandlets, all the functionality, but as GR master. Let's see if it's true. Yes, it is. Well, let's spare ourselves the pingings. It can access the anonymous share. It can also access the restricted share. And it can also list AD user from the domain controller. Okay, so this commandlet, this configuration endpoint, I connect it to as root, and it performs all the actions as GR master, which may or may not be good, because GR master may have extensive rights in the domain, but it may not have some permissions it needs to perform certain actions on some systems like VMware, vSphere or whatever. So now, what happens if we connect or we enter a restricted endpoint? In this case, it says the remote session did not offer all required commandlets. But I can establish a session to that restricted endpoint. Right? Which is open, geo-restricted. And I can then use the session to do stuff, just dump the last username or current username in the C last user txt. I invoke that command, and unsurprisingly, it's GM master that is put into that file. So no surprises here. If I would like to invoke those commands not in script blocks but like interactively, I could import the session into my current session and use a prefix to distinguish the remote commands from the local ones, because I have like a restart service both in the restricted endpoint and in my local session. Which one should it use? So I either say allow clobber, and then I restart all the sessions on the remote target, or I don't say allow clobber, and then I have no access to that commandlet. But if I import them with a prefix, I can have a restricted set of commands that are prefixed, in this case, with a machine name. And if I were to restart a service on only PSConf04 machine, I could just do okay. So, and if I restart it on the local machine, then it just restarts on the local machine. So you could work with that. This is just to demonstrate this tracing transcript capability. So we have restarted a service and we have a Jira transcript sitting here that reflects all this stuff that has happened in this session. Okay. WinRM service restarts. Depending on how well defined the Jira implementation is, it can happen that someone deploys a new configuration at a machine you're currently remoting into, WinRM restarts, and your session becomes what exactly? It does not become disconnected. After Paul's presentation yesterday, I kind of have expected that to just disconnect the session. That is not true. It will actually destroy all the run spaces that have been started remotely. So you can't help yourself by jobs or other long-running tasks to survive a WinRM restart. Depending on what you were doing, it can be benign or it can be catastrophic. You need to deal with that explicitly. What is it that you could do? If you get data out of remote sessions, and those are like many objects, you could put some marker at the end, a specially crafted object that demonstrates that it was the last one, or I don't know, or there are many ways to deal with that. Let's look at some. So jobs do not help against WinRM restart. I connect to another machine. Again, admin rights, default endpoint. Start a job there. And then on that machine, I remotely restart WinRM. So that was unexpected, because it kind of shows that I'm still connected. Yeah, thanks. So then, hoping that WinRM has restarted, I enter the session, a session again. And the job is not there. So to take away out of this, a remoting session does not survive a WinRM restart. Session renewal. In scenarios where you have dealt with spontaneous WinRM restarts and remoting targets, you just might want to make sure that a session is established every time you run a commandlet against it, no matter if it's the same session or a new instance of a session to the same configuration endpoint to the same computer. So you could use a small helper function. It's really basic stuff. It's really basic stuff. It takes a session and it gives, it returns a session. And if the session was running, it returns this very session. If not, the configuration of this session is still in the object in the local PowerShell session. I know which computer and which configuration endpoint the session was established to, so I can basically just reestablish it. I won't find the stuff that I was doing in that session. The session is gone, but I just don't need to care and reestablish the session. Just put this helper function before each execution, and then it does the work for you. We established a new session. The session is there. We use another remoting session against the default endpoint to restart service WinRM. Now we get, of course, an error message. But the session object is still there, and it is in a broken state, which means the local run space is basically it's disconnected. There is no matching remote workspace in that machine for this local machine, for this local run space. So, but I can do reconnecting using nothing more than this session object, and now I have, it's another session. That was number 20. This is number 22, but it is opened. I can use it, and it's been connected to the same machine with the same configuration endpoint. That's all from me for today. So there are challenges. You need to be aware of those. You need to implement some controls to help you overcome those challenges. On the upside, scripts that you develop for running in a constrained environment tend to become more and more robust as they go, because you double check stuff in your scripts. You don't just pipe, get something to do something, but actually ask first if all the objects you expected to find are there. So it's a good scripting practice to do some checks. And feedback about prohibitive limitations within your Jira configuration endpoints can be automated to an extent. So your Jira master becomes aware of you requesting or needing some commandlet. So you can engage in a discussion, or the Jira master can engage in a discussion with you to determine if you really need that commandlet, or if there are other ways to do what you were intending in your script with this commandlet. So now, seeing as I'm the only thing standing between you and launch, are there any questions? The question was if I experimented with script analyzer for the AST stuff. No, it is just for the demo. It's basic stuff. You could, of course, go deeper and use the script analyzer module. I was intending to do so. I actually did in production scenarios, but it's hard to show in a demo because not everybody is familiar with script analyzer. I mean, not everybody is familiar with AST. I think script analyzer it just tends to produce convoluted code if you access that. So it's not that showable, in my opinion. Any other questions? So then, enjoy the rest of the conference. Thank you very much. Go grab lunch.